Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the next exciting installment of the Black Tower podcast. Yay! We're so excited to have you here for this week's dose of madness. We bring to you from the Black Tower the word from on high, the good word of the Lord Dragon, the mouthpiece and champion of the Creator.
I get an amen.
Am your leader of the storms, your Sorovan Mahail, Josh.
Hi.
One of these days, you guys are not going to pause.
I intentionally pause. It gives me time to edit and make it feel like I did something if I don't have to edit anywhere else.
Oh, my bad.
I'm so shutting it. Step it back. Because, hi, guys. I'm Andrew, your Bajah Mahail, or your battle leader. I lead the battles.
Hi, guys. I'm the one who holds the flag. I'm the Amon Khan Mahail. I'm Daniel.
It's shining. Flaps in the wind.
And we thank you for being here. We are truly grateful to see you assemble on the Black Tower Common Grounds, where we will disperse the good word of the Wheel of Time. And rest assured,
assemble!
That's right. The Black Tower will always be here to pour a little bit of madness into your lives. That's just what we do. And that's what we're going to keep doing. Because we love you. We love ourselves. We love ourselves a lot. And we love this crazy, crazy Tirangrial that allows us to speak words into your ears. And I just can't say enough about it. I love it. Witchcraft. I love
say it. Say it right. Use the scientific terminology. Your ear holes.
Your ear holes.
Your ear
that's
holes.
True. And as a matter of fact, if you guys want to bring some shout outs, we've got two people who love it so much that they have entered their names on the rolls of the Black Tower.
It's true.
It is very true. And I am logging in so that I can see the specific. Yep. In about 3 seconds, because even though I was the one that said, guys, we have to do this time, since we didn't record one
intro
last
music,
time.
Intro music. We're going to give some intro.
So one of the people that we have to shout out is Turban Dan, who actually just became a Patreon today.
Turban Dan!
And the other...
Today!
The other did it about 11 days ago, so we apologize for our tardiness. But thank you so much, Monsieur Joe. I'm not going to say your last name because it looks like it might be the actual legal name.
Mr. Joe!
Thank you so much,
Mr. Joe,
for your patronage, quite literally, your support.
This
and
is
welcome
Joe
to the ranks.
And this is Johan.
Joe, you're a badass, and we love you. And
as are you, Turban Dan.
And Turban Dan, you're also a badass, and we also love you. Welcome to the Black Tower.
So, Joe, by the time you hear this, your shout out on Twitter should already be out. I think we can handle that in between the rest of the day tomorrow in the early morning Friday.
Maybe. It depends on how tainty things get between now and then. And you know what else is cool? So you guys all know that we did the What Fandom Championship bracket. You were there for every harrowing, suspenseful moment where different names were voted up and down, and we found a winner, and we finally were able to brand ourselves as Dragonsworn. And it was cool. I think it was really good. I am really happy with the results. But we've already talked about that because you saw our live stream on our YouTube channel, because you subscribed to our YouTube channel and you are super cool about that. But you saw that where we talked about that, where Dragonsworn
super
won.
Cool.
And everything was great there. But what you may not know And this is where I'm going to throw in a bit of a curveball. But what you may not know is that we've designed something truly fantastic, and we've thrown it out upon our spreadsheet. And if you would like to be a member of the Dragon Sworn and actually have a t-shirt, you know what I mean? Join the club. We've got t-shirts. Join the club. We've got jackets. Join the club. We've got face masks. We've got what you need to show the world that you are Dragon Sworn and proud.
We got what you need.
Oh.
Whether it's t-shirts or a mask. Or a hoodie or some slacks. Oh, baby,
I was wondering where you were going to go with that, and you done good, son.
Notice disclaimer.
Made my heart proud.
All merchandise referenced in the song may or may not be available at spreadshirt.com. Because I don't think we have any pants, though I do really want some Black Tower podcast sleep pants that say juicy and tainty across the ass.
Oh, my God. I'm going to see if they've got track pants that we can put tainty on the butt.
I don't think they do.
I feel
do,
like that needs to happen.
But I
my
hope
favorite
I'm wrong.
Would be if on the front it said Black Tower and on the back it said tainty.
I mean,
actually, you know what would be absolutely perfect, but they're never going to actually let you do it, is you just have tainty going from the butthole out to the front.
Oh, my God. Dude.
I don't know if they'll let you write words on the gooch, but who knows? Gooch. Stranger things have happened.
Dude, Stranger Things has happened for 3 seasons. Where have you been?
I am now putting a link to the Dragon Sworn hoodie. You can look in there and you can see all the different merchandising options if you'd like to check it out. You certainly
you
may do
it.
That.
You can
you
put
can
your name
customize
on
it. Customize it. You can put your name on it. And if you want to get a look at
if you
a
like it,
design
then you
logo
put your name on it.
Before it's loaded onto Spreadshirt, you should go over to our Instagram. And Daniel, tell them why they should follow us on Instagram.
Because you will see wonderfully fun stories of us just being crazy Asimon. Today there was a story about the new Dragonsworn logo. We'll be putting up a number of other logos that we have unveiled. I think all of them we've actually unveiled at some point on Twitter, but again, not calling anyone out, but Daniel has been absolute garbage about going ahead and updating these.
That sucks.
That fucking guy.
Okay. All right.
Were we not supposed to agree that quickly?
Daniel is,
hey,
is enough.
Hey, Amon Khan, you might, the flag fell. You might want to pick that up. I love you. Don't hate me.
Do you need us to pick this up for you, or?
No. When I pick it up, I'll just go ahead and show you all this sign. Oh, you all looked.
Oh, I did.
Not gonna lie, I literally did.
It's true. I thought you were gonna pull an Arnold and be like, "Well, I hope you'll save enough room for my feast, because I'm going to ram it into your stomach."
You know what killed the dinosaurs? The ice age.
Nice to see you. No, but our Instagram is popping.
Yes, it is, and it will be popping for at minimum. Minimum the next few days. And then we'll go ahead. Oh no. I will remedy that.
Bitch.
That's trash.
Dude, you know what? That wasn't even me or Andrew like throwing shade.
Yeah, no, that was just legitimately Andril letting us know that Instagram threw me shit.
This is why we love Andril, because he holds our feet to the fire.
Yeah.
Or to
Excelente.
The lava on the other side of the gateway that he's going to weave on our feet. You scary, scary man.
Sometimes, Josh.
Sometimes
you say things.
It's true. Sometimes I do say things.
But yeah, so definitely go ahead and check out Instagram, because it's going to be cool. I will be unveiling in picture format The other fun things that you can get on Spreadshirt, and we have some fun activities planned that are all Ashaman related. So if you want to get in on that or just participate in the enjoyment of it, definitely come on down and join us on Instagram.
Let's see, what else is there? I feel like there's other things too that we should talk about. Really, what I'm doing, gathering. Something is gathering. We've got some.
Yeah, the cast of the Wheel of Time.
We've got some madness gathering. Although I will say this, with this particular announcement, the gathering madness. is going to be the most amazing event that anyone's ever attended or been a part of. Guaranteed 100% or your money back. However, we have to make sure that there isn't still a global pandemic.
Agreed.
So I want all of the next information to be taken with a grain of salt. And that grain of salt should be COVID-19, you suck so hard, and we hate you so much that we would rob the world of the single greatest gathering in the history of gatherings just to make sure that people do not get sick by you.
Truth.
So COVID-19, how do you feel about that, huh? How do you feel? How does that make you feel? You should be ashamed of yourself. Your parents,
I'm ashamed.
SARS and bird flu are also ashamed of you. Okay? They're sick.
Your great great grandpappy, the bubonic plague, is just shaking his damn head.
No, the gathering madness, it's happening October. Okay, October 16, 17, 18 is when the boys in black are going to be all in the same place. And if we're all in the same place, you know it's a party. And you know when the boys in black are having a party, what's better than having a party with the boys in black? More people having a party. Is this...
If you've got a red coat on, go home. If you've got a blue coat on, get the fuck out. If you've got a yellow coats, right out.
That's right. That's not we. This is how we get down. No, just kidding. Come on, you know this. All are welcome at the Black Tower. You guys know that. Come on.
You wear the wrong pin, right to jail.
All are welcome at the Black Tower. We keep the tradition of the Lord Dragon. When he said that men must come to the tower, he said that their families are more than welcome if they are willing. So if you guys are willing, you can bring your families to the Gathering Madness. That's how this works, because we at the Black Tower Podcast understand that we are a group of people who love the Wheel of Time. And I don't care who you are. I don't care where you come from. I don't care what you do for a living. I don't care what specific genetic traits you were born with. And I don't care how you interpret the world around you. If you love the Wheel of Time, we can be friends. Mic drop. But why I'm not dropping the mic because I need friends? To keep recording.
No, it's true.
That's why I put mine on a boom and don't hold it with my hand.
So I feel like that would actually be somewhat difficult.
Drop my desk. It's not a desk flip. It's a desk drop.
You underestimate my power.
The Gathering Madness is going to be great, guys. We're going to have a bunch of people there who love the Wheel of Time. We're going to have some other people there who just love fantasy books in general. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to have food. We're going to have drinks. We're going to have activities. We're going to have games. It's going to be great. It's going to be awesome. And if you can make it, if you happen to be in Ogden, Utah, during that weekend in October, please come by. Please. I'm taking work
off. Bill Dorman says it's going to be the best thing this side of the dragon.
By his aged grandmother.
I wouldn't even invite my aged grandmother to this. Do you actually like your aged grandmother, Vale? Because it sounds like,
dude, that is a
anything for your aged grandmother.
What else is there? I feel like there's other stuff there. I feel like there's other stuff. There's other important things that
need to be said. Yeah. Aren't we giving away something? Or
we yes.
I think yes, maybe a couple things. I don't know. I think a certain Hashima did something on Twitter about it.
We yeah. Thanks, Andrew. So we going back to Dragonsworn. Remember that whole Dragonsworn thing. If you're on Twitter, now I apologize in advance for all of our fans who are not on Twitter. I do recognize that not everybody in the world has a Twitter, and that's okay. We are currently
not everybody in the world is a twit, Josh.
Oh, and you're not wrong. We are working on giveaways and plans for other types of scenarios and situations that will allow us to perform giveaway type events for other social media platforms. I can say indeed, there will be giveaways at the Gathering Madness. We are definitely going to make sure we have some stuff to give away.
What?
You can't just come all the way to my house and leave without walking away with some good stuff. In this case, however, we're promoting Dragonsworn. We are proud of our new fandom name. And every indeed, time you use the hashtag Dragonsworn in a tweet, you get an entry into our giveaway. So you can send out
every
a tweet.
Every time?
Every single time. If you send out a tweet that contains hashtag Dragonsworn at least once, you will get one entry. If you send out another tweet right after that that says hashtag Dragonsworn, you will get another entry. And if you continue doing these things, you will continue getting entries. How long will we be accepting these? Well, you're going to have to tune into our live stream this Saturday. Saturday. Now, when you listen to this episode, if you're not listening live right now, you will get it on Friday the 26th. That's cool. That's really cool.
No, you'll get it on Saturday the 27th.
Oh, will you?
Because Saturday's after Friday.
Well, then you better make sure that you tune in later on today for all of you who are listening to the recording afterwards. That you listen to our live stream, because we're going to announce the final day that we will be accepting entries, and then July the 4th. Oh, that's bad timing.
Is it though?
You know what? No, it's not. July 4th is a great weekend to announce the winner of the giveaway.
Yeah.
Who's with me?
I mean, to be fair, like it being July 4th isn't going to affect people like Androl.
I'm going to be busy doing stuff.
It's not going to affect people like Androl that don't live in the U.S.
They're doing this to me on purpose now.
What?
Either that or we're having some recording issues and I can't hear them anymore.
I think maybe you can't hear.
We can hear you.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Hey, can we get back on topic? Jeez, you guys are messing around with my broken tech.
Wait, do we have a topic tonight?
We do have a topic.
I'm pretty sure for a solid 5 minutes, it sounded like you were manually disassembling and reassembling your entire machine.
Please leave that in the episode.
Don't come at me with that tone of look.
Dude, you have no idea. Like, so you've got to know what was happening in my house right now. So my office, I use the Scarlett 18i8 sound board thing, right? Audio. Okey-doke. What is it? It's an audio input device of some type. And I've been using that for years now. And for some reason, just now, it just was like, nope, screw you. Don't want to work. What you heard.
I just want to bang on the drums all day.
What you heard was me throwing boxes and rifling through the mess of my office looking for one of my previous soundboards, trying to get everything set up.
Did you succeed?
Apparently, yes. Yes, I obviously did, because I'm here now. I now have my Behringer audio device hooked up, and that was the next 10 minutes of bullshit, because it was me trying to figure out what devices do what, because I haven't used it since I was in college.
I have a Behringer box.
Yeah.
It's funny because it's like
you can do two inputs.
Guys, I just realized something.
I can only do one. What did you just realize?
I am Squirtle because I don't have any type of mixer box. Andrew is Wartortle because he has the Behringer box. Josh is Blastoise because he has the Behringer box and the Scarlet box. Just saying.
I didn't know where this was going when you said you were Squirtle.
I didn't either. I was confused. We had some pretty risque conversations earlier, and Daniel busts out with, "I'm Squirtle," and I was like, "Whoa,
where's this going?"
Okay, well, where were we when my Scarlet decided to shit the bed?
So welcome everyone to the Black Tower podcast.
Just start over, Jesus Christ. So while you were gone, Daniel and I, we made the executive decision to, if people can, if they are lucky enough to get shirts or whatever that says Dragonsworn on it ahead of time, or they can show where they've ordered it, each instance of that unique instance, you can't post the same picture 1,000 times, gets you 5 entries into the giveaway.
Indeed.
Which giveaway?
The Dragonsworn giveaway.
Oh, the Dragonsworn giveaway.
Yes.
Oh.
Also, to help us out, if we could either tag us or hashtag Dragonsworn in it, that would be super crazy helpful.
It definitely needs to have hashtag Dragonsworn in it, because
that's how we're finding them all.
Because that's how we're
going to find it.
We're going to find it.
And if you want to buy a Dragonsworn shirt just to be a badass, cool.
Yes. Also, I made the executive decision that if they get any of the other logos, whether it be hashtag Embrace the Taint, the Black Tower logo, the Chibis, that they actually will get 3 entries as well, because it is specifically the hashtag Dragonsworn giveaway. But again, you know, if they want to be badasses and get other merch, I ain't going to be stingy with the entries.
Because ultimately it helps us do more like giveaways and stuff.
It's true.
Because giveaways require capital from somebody, and Bill Gates hasn't returned my voicemail yet. So,
right? What is up with that guy?
Wait,
I was going to try the real Bill Gates. I was going to get him to try to fly all of the Black Tower and our listeners out to Prague to view shooting live, but he just won't answer.
Weird.
Bill Money. I know you're listening.
I've put out a contact to Rafe as well. so we'll see which one of us gets a response first.
You should be like, Rafe, you're from Salt Lake and Josh lives near Salt Lake. You guys are practically related.
Yeah, we're going to send him one of the little cameras disguised in the shirt button so we can get a live stream of part of the production.
No, oh, Josh, I don't think you understand where you live. You live in Utah, not Kentucky.
Yeah.
But anyway, the final, to finish off plugs for us and stuff that's going on and stuff we're doing and all that kind of stuff. The Podbean link, put it out there, blacktowerpod.podbean.com. You can find links to the merch store, to Patreon. If you're listening and not already in the Discord, the link's there. If it doesn't work, send us a message on Twitter. We'll refresh it with a new link, because from time to time, even though I say never expire, they will expire.
Because they're dumb and we hate them.
There's also the Twitter, the YouTube, and everything's there, and our email's under the contact stuff. So all that. So with like what feels like 3 hours of plugs and event announcements and stuff done,
indeed,
the next thing we need is some of that lovely latexy slimy protection so that nobody gets spoiled on today's topic.
Ladies and gentlemen, today's episode will contain spoilers for the entire series of The Wheel of Time. That includes The Eye of the World, The Great Hunt, The Dragon
Reborn, list each book.
A Shadow.
You dick.
That includes books 1-14 of The Wheel of Time. You have been warned that this contains spoilers for books 1-14 of The Wheel of Time.
Ironically,
to some extent, it will also include spoilers for Robert Jordan's The Wheel of Time, also known as The Big White Book of Bad Art, and The Wheel of Time Companion.
Yeah, but
But and frankly, it's possible that it will contain spoilers for the audiobooks of The Wheel of Time.
But no spoilers for New TV Spring. Series. So if you have not read New Spring, you're good.
Correct.
You are good to listen to this episode.
I love how Andrew, how are you on book four when your character doesn't show up until book 11?
I love how live chat is currently plotting a way to sneak somebody in a suitcase into the shooting area.
That's right.
Yes, indeed.
It does contain spoilers for a little time.
We just need to wait until season 3 where they kill Billy Zane's Ishmael.
No!
And then Daniel Byshank can go in and play Moradin.
I mean...
And then he'll get you on set as Trollocs. It's okay.
Okay. I'll take it.
So basically, you'll be cannon fodder for Moradin is what he'll get us on set for. Like, no, they're animatronic. You can legitimately actually shoot them.
No, it's okay. I feel like Andrew will actually play a Terran High Lord. And
enough Josh oil and I can bring
play
the beard to
a Two Rivers Longbowman.
I mean, no, just the longbow, not even a longbowman. The
no, I said
longbowman.
I did actually say longbowman.
Yeah, not the person holding the bow itself.
You're going to be held by Will Alcine. And he will shoot you into the Trolloc storm.
I genuinely...
Because they talk a lot of crap for Trollocs within come shot distance.
I genuinely... Genuinely, oh boy, I give up.
Just, why is it like we?
Tonight we're talking about know Aviendha. The rest of the, yes, we're talking about Aviendha.
Yeah.
Tonight is the third of Rand's wonderful and amazing.
We're finishing off the
relationship,
Dragon Ladies. We're finishing off the Dragon Ladies.
The most sworn of dragon sworn.
That's true. If there were dragon sworn that were more sworn than the rest of the swarm is sworn. Or dragon sworn is a swarm of folks who are sworn to a dragon. Boom.
Josh.
Yes.
You're going to hurt yourself.
You don't have to say it. I'm taking another drink right now.
Yes. Drink more of the wine. It will save you from the madness.
Tainty.
Taint. Like what Arcanus said, the taint. First dragon rider. That should be added taint. To Aviendha's titles. First rider of the
you're
dragon.
Right. She did take his V card, didn't she?
The she first did. Rider of the dragon, speared by the Karakorn.
Nice. She. So sadly, here's the fun part. Min. Yeah, and you've already given you the spoiler warning, so just plot. Min does not get to do the dirty with the dragon. She doesn't get to get down with the dragon till like two books after Aviendha. Elaine is technically the first that gets to get a little frisky, but she only gets secret smooches in the corner of the stone at Tyr.
They smooch in the corner, whereas Rand smooches in Avienda's corners.
Nice. Nice.
Honestly, as I was saying, I was like, that just sounds more and more disgusting, honestly. So I'm just picturing, but you know, like the stereotypical Aviendha. Like the stereotypical like old person that's been eating and they got like the white crusties at the corner of their mouth. That's what I pictured. You're welcome for that image.
Okay, so
this image has been brought to you by Shaitan.
Aviendha. Yeah, take it easy there, Shaitan. Aviendha is the first dragon rider. That is accurate. She is the first one who gets to seal the deal and consummate the goodness with the Lord Dragon himself. And it's a wonderful scene, but we're not there yet.
There's more to Aviendha than just what's under the cotton sore.
Heyo.
She's and not just a Far Dareis Mai, or she's more than a Far Dareis Mai.
That's the thing, is when we first meet her, she's Far Dareis Mai. She is a spear maiden, and she's like, I'm going to kill some shit. I'm going to stab some shit. I got this spear here. I'm going to use it. And she's all about that. She is like ready to just run some Trollocs through or some Shido or some whatever else.
Or some Carianan.
She's just ready to do it. She's ready to do the damn thing. She's ready to get down.
Aviendha is bae from start to finish.
It's true. She's a badass. And the cool thing is you know what I love most about
her? She's badass.
Heyo. She gets called out by the wise ones early on, right? And they're like, you need to go to Ruidian. And
trying forever.
They're like scolding her. They're like, get your ass to Ruidian. You can't do this anymore.
Get in Ruidian.
And the reason why she's in trouble. Now, just think about this for a second. The reason why she's in trouble with the wise ones is because she doesn't want to stop stabbing things with her spears.
Sounds like Rand.
I think it's worth noting like what they have to go through to finally get the message to her, because they're all in the Stone of Tyr and they're like, Moraine's like, all right, we got to go. I think it was like while they were in the Stone of Tyr, right? The Moraine gets visited by the wise one who's in her dreams, right? I'm not crazy, right?
No.
Yeah. The wise one.
Okay. And then they're all like, you need to come here.
Everybody. And they're like, information drop. Boom.
Yeah. I love how it happens because Moraine is like, we got to go. And Aviendha is like, good luck on your quest, fellow adventurers. I'll be going off on my own. And Moraine's like, actually, no. The wise one said you have to come too. It's time to stop running away. And I forgot the phrase she used, but it was something that was like humorous, but also like insulting enough to Aviendha as who she is as a person and what her identity is about to make her feel too embarrassed.
If I remember correctly, she's like, the wise ones say that you're too old to be wearing your hair in braids and you need to come to Ruidian or something like that.
And Moraine's like, yeah, okay, whatever that is, but I'm Aes Sedai, bitch, so listen to me.
And
good shout, Aviendha. Moraine gets a letter from Ruart. Because he was given a letter whenever he left the Aiel Waste.
Tim Curry energy, and you got a letter, and you got a letter, and you got a letter, and you got a letter.
Everything important happens in letters.
I'm going to the one place capitalism can't find me. The Wastes!
The Aiel Wastes. So then they travel out to the Wastes, and it's funny too because Aviendha gets super sulky.
She does.
And she like they go out there and when they finally arrive on the hilltop through a series of events, it's great because the wise ones are like, okay, get in there. And she's like, what? No, I don't know. And they're like, no, get the fuck in there. And they like take her spears away from her.
And they break them.
And they're like, you are not Far Dareis Mai. Get your naked ass into that city now. And she's like, fine. And she strips down. She's crying. She's pissed. And she goes, bam. And that's
takes off running.
Yeah, she does. And that's after Moraine went.
Catches up to Moraine. Yeah. Passes her on the way. Runs into the clouds, turns into a wise
man. Matt sees her in the distance. He's like, it must be the heat, but I swore I saw a naked IL woman run by. I swear, that's but right. It's got to be the heat. Because, you know, in Matt's mind, he's like, I couldn't be so lucky that a naked woman just ran past me.
Right? They're still pretty wet behind the ears as far as the ways of the world.
That as far as we're ears. Aware,
hey-o.
Matt is actually so lucky that he would see a naked woman run around in the waste.
We know, but he thinks it was one of them there desert mirages.
Going naked into the city. Really, it's the only way to do it.
I mean, it's the only way unless you have a dick.
No, well, there is that. If we want to start.
That is true for in the series. I don't think that's true for New York.
So Aviendha goes down there.
I'm sure that there are definitely some women who could get away with running around New York naked.
Yeah. Well, and we're kind of jumping ahead to Ruidian, which isn't when we first meet Aviendha.
When do we first meet Aviendha, Andrew?
So we first meet Aviendha when
there's Egwene, Elaine, and Nynaeve on their way to Tyr.
Right.
And Aviendha and her group, who consist of Bane, Chad, and Jolene, they were attacked by the Kyrian. And Nynaeve says, right. Hey, can you heal my friend? Because Nynaeve and all of them are like, yeah, we're totes Aes Sedai.
Yeah.
Totes magotes Aes Sedai.
And it's Dai Lin, who is another maiden who's been wounded. And Nynaeve they Nynaeve, yeah, Nynaeve succeeds in healing her, only for her to, of course, later die. Because Aviendha and company go and rescue the three. I don't want to say amigos. Is it amigas? Does it just change to an A in Spanish?
Technically, yes.
Yeah, so you can say amigas. The Spanish Spanish for female friends, rescues them from, they've been captured by a murderall. Ruark is with them as well, not with the capture party, but with the rescuing party. And it's then that Dailene dies fully.
Which, this is actually, I'm actually really glad you backtracked to this, because I love this scene. Because as they are all in the, because what, Egwene, Nynaeve, they've been captured. And they're being sold. And you find out that the guys who captured them are actually speaking to a Myrdral. And they're like, yeah. Oh, shit. We are so screwed, guys. I don't know what's going on. And then all of a sudden, the Aiel bust in. They kill everyone. And the Myrdral is standing like right in the middle of the room, and they're circling the Myrdral, veiled, rattling their spears on their bucklers, and they're like, dance with me, Myrdral. Dance with me, Myrdral. Dance with me, Iris.
You want to play Maiden's Kiss, Myrdral?
And I love that this is the first time, because when you hear about a Myrdral, the first thing they say is to look at a Myrdral is just fear. Absolute fear.
To look and at a Myrdral is to look at fear itself.
Far Dareis Mai, who are looking at a Myrdral in the face, and they're goading it. They're like, yeah, dance with me. And I love it. It is great. And Aviendha's right there. And actually, Andrew, that was a really good point. I am glad you brought that back, because that, I think it's a real important point.
Well, because it does a lot for Aviendha's relationship with Egwene and Elaine, right? Because they saved one of her spear sisters.
Yeah.
And then she comes and saves them. And with IL custom, according to Aviendha, they are now near sisters.
Mm-hmm. And
so that sets a very early precedent for things that happen after the fancy, nice, steamy, hot igloo.
Hey-o. All right. No.
Yes, well, and again, this is one of those instances where before we even know what's going on, and when you go back and you read through again in your read-through, mm-hmm. you're like, oh, shit, Dailene and Aviendha have toe.
Yes.
And then they come and save Egwene and Nynaeve, and they're like,
we're good.
Toe expended. Yeah, like
exactly,
the toe has been met, and Egwene just looks at her feet like, "The fuck are you talking about?"
It's, okay, sure.
Terrible joke.
It's true though; they do that. But the cool part is it speaks to Aviendha's character. She mm-hmm. is brave.
She's not fearless.
She's not fearless. She can still feel fear, but she's courageous in that. The fear does not control her decisions, because she's
also 99.9% sure that's actually what fearless means. Not actually lacking fear, but just lacking the,
I mean,
I think the word itself literally means void of fear.
Hey, Andrew, shut the fuck up.
Hey, you know what? This is a Wheel of Time podcast, not a linguistic podcast. Okay. So that's, get your grammar bullshit out of here. So anyway,
Robert Jordan is shaking his head from on high. Yeah.
So fast back forward. Aviendha wanted to go with Elaine and Nynaeve to Tanchico, but she gets the letter. goes to Ruinion with Rand, Egwene, Moraine, and Lan. Wise Ones break her spears, send her naked ass to Ruinion.
She sees some shit.
Yeah.
We don't know what she sees, though.
But we know she sees some shit.
Yeah.
Because they all see some shit.
Those
Tyrion, Greal, and Ruidion, I think, could be renamed as like PTSD inducers. Because they like.
Why don't they just make these Tyrion, Greal more intense? These Tyrion, Greal go to 11.
Turn it up to 11. Oh, man. That's terrifying.
Yeah. So she goes into Ruinion. We know she goes in and she comes out. At the time, we don't know what she's seen or anything like that. All we're left to assume is that it's got to be, we think, at least somewhat similar to Rand. We find out later that it's very different. Same idea, just opposite direction, right? Because Rand sees into the past.
Sort of.
No, Rand sees into the past.
And Aviendha sees into possible futures.
Okay. So again, reminder. No, the first time.
Do we get to see what Aviendha saw the first time?
We don't ever get to see what she saw, but she tells us about it later on.
Yeah, that's true.
Because she also meets Nakomi. As Arcanus just said, and this is very important, Aviendha actually finds out everyone else when Rand fucks everybody's brain holes.
Right.
Because the wise ones go to Ruidion twice, whereas the clan chiefs only go to Ruidion once.
Right.
Because the wise ones go to basically do the accepted test for Aes Sedai.
Right.
In the three rings in Ruidion. And then they go back a second time after they've actually done a bunch of training to go through the crystal columns. Presumably, Aviendha actually sees her past life and other possibilities that they could have taken, or, you know, things that she doesn't want to let go of, her present life and things that she doesn't want to let go of, and then her possible futures. Where she sees a lot of shit that she doesn't want to necessarily see.
So I think this is, another kind of important distinction to make, because this is one of those scenarios in which you can read the books. You can read the books 100 times and never make that connection, right? The connection that she went through, she had already gone through Ruidion when Rand comes out and says, "My ancestors followed the way of the leaf, and all of you Aiel have toe, and all of you Aiel have broken your promises, and that's how you failed the Aes Sedai."
And she is pissed at him, along with literally everyone else.
Yeah. And so, I never really made that connection until just this moment. And the idea that what she saw that first time through was not the past just really outlines how different the experience is for each person who goes through the trials at Ruidion.
A huge difference between how the wise ones go through it and how the clan chiefs go through it. Because again, if you're a wise one, if you go into Ruidion, you are doing effectively the test for the accepted. And you don't find out that information until so much later. You go through so much training and so much testing and so much everything before you find out how fucked up you have had your history.
And I love how it's revealed, because Rand's like, "If you've been there, then you know this is the truth." And everybody's and like, "It's a lie." When he's talking to the entire IL.
Yeah.
And then the wise ones and the clan chiefs are like, "You can't say that." And then Coldane is like, "You're lying.
God damn it, Karen, it's a lie. You can't just ask people why they're white."
And then the clan chiefs and the wise ones just kind of like look at their feet and look around, because they're like, "I can't lie deliberately, because
that's yeah. against Giotto.
And the thing is that, and I know this kind of sidetracks from Aviendha, but it's the Black Tower podcast. Get over
How
it.
Dare you?
But when Jeez, Rand man. Says this and Culloden is like, ah, oh, you lie. We are warriors. We've always been warriors. Up until this point, everybody kind of had this doubt, like, oh shit, what do we do? Because they both have dragon tattoos on two arms. We don't know if Culloden went in without permission, blah, 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 blah. He came back with the dawn. Like, so far things are lining up and we don't know. And it is a real big moment because at that time, Aviendha is still looking at Rand going, and keeping in mind that she's still very much trying to put aside her Far Dareis Mai tendencies and evolve into something bigger, into something more as a wise one of the Aiel. And then Rand is like, oh, I saw my ancestors as they followed the way of the leaf. Not only are we talking about something that is in direct contradiction to the way of the Aiel, but not only that, now you're saying that you're just exactly like the Athaan Mier, who we despise. The Tinker, lost ones.
Not Athaan Mier.
Or, I'm sorry.
Tuathan.
Tuathan, thank you. Athaan Mier is the people of the sea. The
you got the Han right. part right.
I did. Indeed. I got the apostrophes in there.
I absolutely agree with you, Josh. And again, to put this in perspective, imagine just the absolute ridiculous upheaval that Aviendha is going through. Because again, we don't find all of this out till later. But once you're done with the books, you look back at her utter upheaval at that point. Because she has gone from being a 100% Kool-Aid drinking Far Dareis Mai. Aiel as fuck.
I really warrior like the cherry flavor.
Woman spear wielding Aiel woman.
Oh yeah.
Who is as far into that as you can possibly be and is literally putting off being one of the most revered people in the Aiel society because she is so hard down the path of being a Far Dareis Mai.
She is Xena warrior princess crossed with Chuck Norris.
Dude, if Xena and Chuck had a baby, it would be Aviendha.
Right? And so now take that person.
Take that person. Tell them that
they cannot have what they have known. They cannot have their spears. They cannot have their cat and sword. They do not get to be that person. They are a wise one, and they are going to be forced to be a wise one.
Yes.
Boom, get naked, go to Ruidi.
Here's everything you've ever known and loved. Now get rid of it.
You run
That is a substantial
Ruidi,
sacrifice.
Especially hoping that it's going to tell you what you want to hear.
Yeah.
You go through these three, you know, archways, and you have to give up being a Far Dareis Mai again, one imagines.
Yeah.
Possibly even twice. And then you find out that this guy that you have absolutely no respect for, barely even know, and think is actually kind of a dumbass.
Kind yep. of
is literally the person that you are going to be in love with,
because we do learn later on that is something she learned.
Yeah. Yes, it is what she sees in her future.
I mean,
or at least a possible future. And granted, again, we know that sort of that is not a requirement, and she could have fought against that, and it's not something that needed to come to pass. But at the same time, it was a possible future. And not only that, it was actually what her heart was telling her.
I mean, what I love about it is it's almost this Confucian-esque, you know, proverb, you know, those who seek to avoid their future often wind up causing it. And that's right. That's what happens with her, because
one often meets
she's
his
like
destiny on the path he takes to avoid it.
Yeah, because she's doing all this and she's not treating him kindly at all. you know, she's very, very blunt and very aggravated at Rand for, I've taught you about IL customs 1,000 times. Why can't you just get it through your thick wetlander skull with that fake bottle red hair? And
okay, so to be fair, that does actually happen afterwards.
Yeah, I'm talking about after she sees everything.
Yeah,
because what happens after that is that the wise ones task her with getting closer to Rand. You will be his teacher.
Yes.
With the ultimate goal, what they want to happen is for her to wind up sleeping in his tent with him and to become, to whatever degree it means, intimately involved with him. That's what they want. Because they're like, we need the Karakorn tied firmly to the IL, and you're going to do it.
And they almost do it on purpose. Aviendha
makes a good thread.
They almost do it on purpose as well, because they know, first off, as a wise one, you can't be so wishy-washy, right?
Yeah.
People are going to test you. People are going to challenge you. And you have to show that you have the spine to be able to stand up and defend your hold, your people, your friends, and whatever. And she's like, no, I am a Far Dareis Mai. I know how to stand up for things. And people are like, slow down. We're not talking about physical threats. We're talking about you need to have the wisdom and spiritual strength, the strength in your soul and in your heart, that when someone challenges you, that you are able to handle the situation in a way that preserves life.
Yeah. What are they saying? And Aviendha is like, hey, I got all of that strength shit from being a Far Dareis Mai, and I've already met Nynaeve, so I've got the wisdom.
Yeah.
Jesus,
yeah.
Leave me
it
alone.
It takes wisdom to tell people to go fuck themselves.
Without causing a blood feud. Because what is it that the wise ones always say to Rand? We're going to save as many as we can.
Yes.
So in many ways, quite literally, Aviendha, her world has been in every single aspect reversed.
Well, and again, we're not even done with the story, because again, we've gone through all of that, and this is already enough to make even the most fucking, you know, hardy, strong, smart, capable, you know, Marine, Navy SEAL, Army grunt, whatever it is, kind of fucking have a seizure. Like, this is already enough to fuck somebody up. But it doesn't even stop there, because again, Andrew just touched on the entire journey from Ruidian to Cold Rocks.
Yep.
Now, Aviendha is doing her absolute best. Her absolute best to try and teach Rand what she already feels like he should know, what she learned as a two-year-old, what he looks like he should already be familiar with, and it literally, maybe not literally, but almost every single turn, Rand makes the wrong decision, says the wrong thing, does the wrong thing, absolutely does not understand Jito at all.
Aviendha has gray hair.
He was raised in the West.
I love
And Jito is so ridiculously different than what he was raised on. And it is so difficult for him to actually wrap his head around the nuances of this completely different system. But again, Aviendha is standing there looking at the face of the man that she will fall in love with.
A man she hates.
A man she hates. And he's standing there getting every single answer wrong. And she's like, how the fuck am I supposed to love you when you have no
such a wool head?
When you are possibly the dumbest person I've ever met in my life.
So
and then they get to the meeting place.
So next,
and all of a sudden, Rand literally ruins everything she has ever believed in her whole entire existence. And she is wishing that Cooladin went to Ruidian and that he had found out that they were warriors and that he's right and fuck all this Tinker bullshit because that's stupid and the Way of the Leaf is dumb and it's absolutely not true. Cooladin's right. Rand is... Wait, what? Rand is actually right?
It's literally everything she thought was good, accurate, and right about the world. Opposite.
Yes.
It's like, you know how when you were a kid and you'd be like, haha, it's opposite day. So when you said you weren't stupid, haha, you're stupid. Aviendha had an opposite day that never ended.
Right.
You're a Far Dareis Mai. You're going to kill people. Guess what? Now it's Tuesday. Now you're a wise one and you must preserve life at all cost unless it's shadow spawn or tree killers. Oh, okay, cool. Well, at least I know we've all been warriors from the very beginning of time. That's a so stupid story. Thought. Wait, what? Oh, okay. Well, this guy's clearly an idiot, man. I hate this guy. Oh, by the way, you're going to fall in love with him. What? Oh, come on. I can just see like Aviendha like desk flip like 8 times in a single day.
Well, it's that image of Jim Carrey just drinking the glass of water. It's just over and over again. Liar, liar. Every single time she tries to drink a glass of water, which we all know to Aiel is sacred as fuck. Always just a, oh, come on moment.
See, here's the thing I love so much about Aviendha. In her story, it's her absolute aversion. I will cut my own throat before I even appear to be vulnerable, right?
Mm-hmm.
When they cross the spine of the world, or she sees the wetlander customs of bathing and, in their opinion, wasting water, she's repulsed by it. And the very first time, the first few moments that she decides, let me see what this is about, and indulges in it. Who walks in and catches her but the absolute fucking dunce moron that her fate is telling her you are going to love? And in that moment, she does something that is absolutely incredible that no Aes Sedai has done in centuries. And makes a fucking gateway. No, not what Nynaeve hasn't done.
Oh. Yeah. She travels.
A gateway and travels. Something she can't do again for quite a while.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow, because I can't remember, does Rand do something to force it to stay open or does it just happen? Yeah,
he basically jams a proverbial stick in it.
It's a foreshadowing moment where she instinctually opens. Heyo. She instinctually opens. So all of this comes to a head. It's one of those, it's the straw that broke the camel's back.
The camera's back? I like it.
We can't use words, guys.
All of this, she's just had these things piled on and piled on and piled on and piled on and piled on. And she finally gets to the point, I can't even remember the circumstance that leads up to it at this point in time, not the specifics of it anyway. And it's not even that she was bathing because, you know, she would bathe in front of Rand just to taunt him, just to be like, ha-ha.
She would Aiel bathe, not wetlander bathe.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so, and that's what it is. Thank you, Andrew. And so she actually decides to take a wetlander bathing session. And Rand comes in and sees her. And
in her shame.
And she can't even. She is like.
She does the biggest nope. She is nope
the most
ever.
Basic white girl.
Guys, if you're.
She becomes the absolute bleach blonde, Starbucks carrying, Ugg boot wearing, yoga pants traveling, dog purse Karen, I can't even, the world has ever seen.
If you're skimming through
and
the books,
the fuck out of there.
If you're skimming through the books with us, I can tell you right now that we are in Fires of Heaven right around chapter 50. It's the only thing I can recall with 100% absolute certainty.
And it's not for the nasty, perverted reasons you think. It's because I saw this shit. I know that's what everybody thinks, but it's for the fact that I saw this coming with Aviendha. It was so obvious to me as something that was going to happen in the plot of the story. And I still love every second of it. And anytime, like when I start my third reread, because I'm about two chapters away from the last battle chapter in Memory of Light right now.
Oh, snap.
And when I get around to the third reread, and I go to open up Fires of Heaven, bruh, so much excite.
Fires of Heaven.
I think my next reread is actually, I'm going to go ahead and I'm actually just going to read it out loud.
Isn't that the grand prize of the giveaway, the hashtag Dragonsworn giveaway? Weird.
Hey, we're talking about Aviendha right
now. It's a weird coincidence. Real
world,
keep
the real world out of this.
Yeah.
So Aviendha, listen,
I was like 5 seconds away from telling Josh to say no to the donator to choose another book, because there are others that I would personally.
There are other books in the series.
Shut the fuck up, Daniel. That I was going to buy The Fires of Heaven, and I gave that up so that you guys could have an amazing giveaway. I want to put a note in there that says, from my favorite Igloo to yours.
Maybe we should all send it to each other and autograph it before we send it to the winner.
Autograph a piece of paper to put in it, not the actual book.
There you go.
Not as a first edition print. All right, you can't do it.
Andrew, I need you to get a piece of paper and autograph it and then send it to Daniel. And then Daniel, you got to send it to me and then I will slide it in the book and send it off to our winner.
I like how I knew everything that you were saying, but you did technically tell Andrew to sign the piece of paper, and you did not tell me to sign it. Apparently, he's just sending it to me so that I can send it to you.
I was hoping that you were intelligent.
We're going to send shit to California to send it back to Utah.
Aviendha
caught in her shame.
She instinctually, and this is a whole other subject that maybe we need to do a show on. Let us know. Send us a tweet. Send us an email. Send us a DM on Instagram if you want us to do a whole episode
into my DMs
about instinct and channeling.
Oh, I was going to say, like, I love Aviendha as much and often more than the next guy, but I can't do a whole episode on Aviendha naked bathing. Like, that's just distasteful.
Yes, you can.
I have the physical ability. but I also have the mental capacity to know that it's a bad fucking idea.
With
he'll just do that alone tonight.
The channeling peoples. So
honestly, that I think that would actually be a really fun.
She jumps up, she creates a gateway, runs out. Rand also instinctually throws up some kind of a barrier to keep it from closing and then runs through.
Oh, he has the forethought to see that she just ran into a fucking blizzard still covered in water.
Exactly.
With no clothes.
Exactly.
So he literally just grabs every blanket he can and runs through like Igor running after Dr. Frankenstein.
Yes, he does. And he chases her down. And I think they find, what is it like? I don't want to say it's like a full mile, but she runs for a good while away from the gateway.
Well, because Aiel are horse people.
They really are, dude.
They just run forever.
They're centaurs in human form.
So they finally
basically Aiel are the knights from Monty Python.
She's Usain Bolt before Usain Bolt was Bolt.
Nice.
They're running as though they were on horses, but they're not on horses. And you just hear this the whole time. Just
he's fast as fuck, boy.
I need to get some coconut shells and start doing that randomly throughout the show.
Someday.
So,
will they be brought to you by African or European swallows?
I guess we'll never know.
You really should know that.
Anyway,
coconuts are actually very important.
Aviendha, naked as a jaybird, in her birthday suit, as exposed to the world as the day she was born, and never before embarrassed to be so, finds herself embarrassed.
Had never seen snow.
Yeah, finds herself embarrassed, nopes out so hard
that she forgets every instinct and doesn't even realize where she is, what the fuck she's doing, and does in any other circumstance that wasn't life-threatening, something that would be absolutely comedic for a wetlander and abhorrent for an IO, and runs out onto a frozen, the top at least, frozen river.
She's been in life-threatening situations. The threat of her life facing down a Murdral was not as bad as Rand seeing her bathe in the wetlander fashion.
Dude, guys, did we just discover that Aviendha is actually the person in the books who has the most toxic masculinity?
Oh my god. Don't say that around Andrew, though. He'll get pissed off. He loves Aviendha.
Okay, I won't say it around Andrew. I will never say such a thing around Andrew. He will never hear me say that.
I will find you. And I will make you reread chapter 52 of Fires of Heaven over and over until you die.
Oh, I like where this is going. No, it's true
though. I have a very particular set of skills.
I'm sure
I've gotten over a long career.
Listen, sir.
I'm sure if you want to get into
it. If you give me back my Aviendha now, that'll be the end of it. But if you don't, I will find you.
And I will kill you.
She stood in one smooth motion, surprisingly pale where the sun had not touched her, slender and hard muscled, yet with roundness and softness that haunted his dreams. And that phrase will haunt your dreams.
I like where this is going.
Just a really anticlimactic action shot of me sitting on a plane for fucking ever going to California.
Especially because you already know where I live. There's no finding me. You know where I am.
I'm just going to knock on the door and be like, Rusty, let me in.
Let me in.
Wait, are you going to be like, are you going to be like Eric Andre? Let me in. Yes. Let me in.
Yes, exactly. I'm going to close the little gated door there just so I can shake it and scream. Which isn't unusual for LA, so I'm not worried about the cops being called.
You'll fit right in.
Nice. Very nice.
Anyway, so they run through. Actually
be like state motto.
Yeah.
But the thing is that Rand, and this is the funny thing, is that up until this point, Aviendha has done a number of things to try and be like, screw you, Rand. You're a dick and I don't like you.
You're not my real boyfriend.
Stupid. She scolds him. Like, she schools him so strictly when it comes to the ways of the Aiel. And she scolds him so harshly for failing to understand things.
I'm going to scold you so hard.
Yeah, exactly. And at one point in time, she even says, you know, she makes the gift of the dragon belt buckle, right? And it was made from the spearhead and arrowhead and short knife and blah, 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 blah. The materials that she used as a Far Dareis Mai, they took her weapons, forged them into gifts and said, you need to give this to three people. What was it? Three people you love and three people you hate.
Yeah.
And so she did. She made a gift. And she straight up tells Rand. She straight up tells Rand, here's a belt buckle. I have to give it to someone I hate more than anything in this world. And he's like, what the hell? What did I do?
That because of what happens in Fires of in chapter 52, maybe 51 of Fires of Heaven, we realize it's not actually Rand she hates. It's anything that signifies her having to give up who and what she has been her entire life. Because she's not a young girl. She's not an Ebbins Field chick that just was able to braid her hair of marriageable age and winds up rejecting Rand. It's nothing like that.
Hold on just a second.
That was specific, Andrew.
Because this is actually a thing that's happening in chat right now, and I want to address it. Arcanus, do you remember that he did get two gifts?
Oh, yeah. Shit. Yeah, at one point in time,
he does get two gifts.
Aviendha tries to buy. She has this idea that
she tries to buy her toe.
Yeah. She thinks she has toe to Rand. I can't remember why she thinks that. And Rand is like, oh, no, we're good. We're good.
Well, there are two reasons that she thinks she has toe.
Well, but see,
number one, for the gift thing, because he gives her the bracelet.
Yeah. Well, see, the thing is,
number two, it's because he saves her in the England.
I mean, he does get multiple gifts from her, but the two gifts don't count towards the 3-2 loves and 3-2 hates. Because Laman's sword is not made from any part of metal of anything she ever had. That is just
sure.
a part of a fifth or something that she acquired.
I'm disagreeing with you as far as the like denotative, like actual meaning behind the two or three gifts that she has to give to people that she hates and three gifts that she has to love. But I think I would not be at all surprised if Robert Jordan actually put that into the story partially to, in some ways, signal that she gives him the belt buckle because she hates him and gives him the sword because she loves him.
Well, I mean, because when he gives her the bracelet,
that sounds like a very Robert Jordan thing to do.
Yeah. Well, when he gives her the bracelet, according to IO custom, that's tantamount. What the hell is tantamount? Tantamount.
It's the marriage wreath.
Basically proposing. And by giving him Laman's sword or Layman's sword, it's supposed to be like an almost canceling out. Because the thing is, we've talked enough about the sex to know what happens. Rand fissures are out, survival instincts kick in, he realizes she has no clothes, there's no way to keep her dry. The only way he can warm her is to, and this is something that's legitimate. It's taught in like even Boy Scouts know this. It's you survival. Shoot down, use skin to skin contact for transfer of heat to keep somebody 100% alive. And that's what Rand does. And he's
both under a ridiculous or as many blankets as Rand could hold.
Too many blankets for me to have sex under. I guarantee that shit.
I mean, have you ever tried to have sex in an igloo?
Not in an igloo, but it is on the bucket list. There you go. Preferably with somebody that cosplays Aviendha. So, ladies, hit me up.
Let's be honest. You live in a relatively warm part of the country.
But I love snow.
Of course you can't have sex under a blanket.
Yeah, that's true. But
I live in California. I can't even have sex without a blanket. Ayo. So,
this shit happens. This shit happens. Aviendha comes to, she awakes from her cold-induced pseudo-cryogenic slumber, looks at Rand, sees that he's essentially naked at the time, and I can run from my fate no longer. You know, it's like Thanos with Destiny. Run from it, avoid it, Destiny arrives all the same. I do, and there's the dragon's dragon.
Rawr.
They do their thing.
It's funny. I thought you were going to go with the other Thanos line. The I don't even know who you are.
So they do the deed. Obviously unplanned and everything. But Aviendha is like, I can't run from this anymore. And Rand's like, you're hot. And I can't form the words to say no, but I'm sure Perrin or Matt could, because they're so much better with women than I am, but I don't not naked. Want this.
And yeah. I'm naked.
He goes full like hillbilly hick. I can say that because I'm Southern and grew up pretty redneck.
Well, and so, and he is.
I guess this is maybe kind of okay still because Elaine and I didn't have some sex.
It's okay for him.
So like maybe I'll be okay.
He came from the backwater. He came from the freaking boonies, man.
He was in the boonies of the boonies.
Boonies. You can't get any more boonies than Emmons Field. And he didn't even live in Emmons Field. He lived several miles outside of Emmons Field.
He was in the boonies.
You know what's more boonies than Emmons Field?
I'd like to introduce you here to these here Sean Chan.
Oh god.
Fuck the Sean Chan.
Here's a fun fact.
We got canonical Texan accents to tell you what.
How many people during this scene realized, because when they flee, it's not autonomy air soldiers that chase them off or are waiting by the gateway. It's Sean Chan.
Oh yeah.
It's how many Sean people Chan. Realized that this is a sea folk island with a Sean Chan army? Yeah.
That's one of those details that you don't catch unless you go reread. And do a reread.
Reread. Because
you go, wait a minute. The Sean Chan are on a sea folk island?
The Wheel of Time is like sunscreen. Sunscreen. You have to reapply.
Sunscreen. No, but
no, honestly, the Wheel of Time is absolutely one of those things that you have to reread. It is Inception. It is Memento. It is The Prestige.
Oh, yeah.
It is all of them.
It is.
So they finish their coitus. They make it back. They let the gateway close.
Oh, my God. Allison Hannigan is at Aviendha.
Oh.
I'm fine with it.
Bruh.
So they do all that.
I want it really bad now.
Too old
to begin.
Because is this when they allow the gateway to close and it cuts off the front half of the Sean Chan? No, that doesn't happen yet.
No. Yeah,
that is exactly when this happens.
They have to find their way back to the gateway. Yeah. That's the thing.
Correct.
They don't.
And there are Sean Chan waiting at the gateway,
blinded by her shame and her desire to get the fuck away, that she doesn't even know where she ran. She just knows she ran away.
And she ran. She ran so far away.
Your tempo is a little slow.
Couldn't get away.
But they come back, and at one point in time, they're like, yeah, dude, anybody who can channel, like, can feel this from a mile away. Like, this is ridiculous.
Yeah.
And it was super cool because the other thing is like Aviendha eventually learns another way to weave a gateway, but she can't remember how she did it that one time. She knows that if she could remember how she did it that one time, she could do it way more easy, use way less of the power, blah, 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 blah. And it, again, it's another one of those instincts of those who use the power and the very nature of weaving the power. I feel like there's a lot to be said there. But
there is.
The other cool thing about it, though, is that Asmodine kind of saves their bacon. Because remember, at this point in time, Rand is being trained or taught by Asmodine. And he runs through the gateway also, correct, not thinking of anything. And then Asmodine is like, holy crap, like, who is weaving Saidin? And even he looks at Rand and goes, I didn't even know this was possible. I did right? what I could to save this.
I effectively threw a tarp over what you did because I don't even fucking know what you did,
He had an entire night to study it as well.
And right?
he still was like, I don't even know what you did.
Now, granted, I will throw out there that to Asmodian's credit, he does have the block at that point, and it is super significant. Yes. So if he was actually at his full power, he might have been able to figure it out, with being able to, right, like, legitimately experiment with it and whatnot. Yes. But at the same time, he's still, like, standing there being like, dude, are you sure you're not Luz Theron? Because, like, the fuck.
Yeah, no, for sure. And this is one of the things that, you know, keeps the Forsaken on their toes, right? Is because they keep seeing these instances of Rand doing things that Rand really shouldn't know how to do. And Asmodine has an intimate insight into this, as he's the one who's been training Rand for the past, mm-hmm, I don't know how long at this point. And so, yeah, so they're pretty scared. And then when Aviendha starts to see how revered Rand is, it kind of, her journey is one of, I think her journey is very reminiscent or a very mirror-like journey of everyone, of the entire story of the Wheel of Time. You have a person who is born into a situation, and this is the way it is. This is how it is. This is how it's always going to be. And one day, all of that is flipped upside down.
And one day, all of the Fire Nation
attacked. And one day, the Fire Nation attacked. That's right. All of the norms, all of the things she understood, all the things she knew for a fact, not only were they challenged, but they were downright
up in smoke.
Boom. Now, a lot of people like to talk about the Wheel of Time like, oh, the Seanchan are so terrible and they keep slaves through the whole time. And yeah, the Seanchan are terrible. They are.
They're meant to
be. But what Robert Jordan does, they're meant to be, exactly. But what Robert Jordan does, something absolutely pristinely amazing. Because he shows humanity at its best and at its worst. And I would argue that Aviendha is illustrated as humanity at its best. Because when all of her norms are challenged, she doesn't cry about it. I mean, she's pretty stubborn about it, and it takes some time for her to fully accept it.
Are you saying Aviendha's Batman or Batwoman?
I'm Batman. But she is strong.
Rand.
Courageous.
You have to.
And she faces it with the same tenacity that she faces every battle. And in the end, she is willing to accept change. She is willing to be humble and accept new perspective and new learning about things that she's known all her life to be true. And Robert Jordan, and I'm sorry, I know I'm kind of getting on a serious tangent here, but Robert Jordan writes this into her character, I believe, very specifically and very intentionally, because there are some people who are humble and who will sit down and say, this is a thing that is true. It has been true my entire life, and there's nothing anybody can do to tell me any differently. And then someone comes along and says, oh, by the way, that's not true. And you've got two kinds of reactions to that. One is, you're a jerk and I don't like you, and I can't believe you would ever challenge my perceptions of the way the world is. And the second one, which is probably the more enlightened approach, is, that's an interesting approach. I'll have to think about that. And even though it's not easy to accept, Aviendha is one of the most emotionally, spiritually, and mentally superior characters in this story, because she is, in the end, able to accept the new perceptions and the new way that the world works, and to actually even thrive in that new environment. And I think
that's
so important to take note of.
Yes. And one of the things I actually want to note, sort of just, you know, going off of that as well, is that I also love how Robert Jordan doesn't just make her the perfect human being.
Exactly.
She absolutely still goes into situation and is like, hey, Nynaeve, this guy's bothering you, right? Should I stab him?
She definitely
and
still
Nynaeve's
makes
mistakes. Like, no!
The best thing Robert Jordan does with his characters is he never, and he made sure, whether by notes or whenever they were able to talk in person, made sure Brandon Sanderson never did, is made sure that no character, no person in this entire story ever forgot their upbringing and where they came from, ultimately. Yeah. As part of the story,
indeed,
for sure. There are times where Rand and company forget where they came from and where they started. And it's part of what makes like Rand's redemption arc. And we'll get into that.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Rand Althor.
But that never disappears. Rand,
yes.
Matt,
it's
Perrin,
always
Egwene,
something that
Nynaeve.
Keeps on coming back around.
Yeah, the Emmonsfield Five always still act the same way someone from Amon's Field would. Aviendha always acts like an IL. Elaine always acts as this girl, as this, you know, young female, but also as somebody born into and trained by Andor nobility. That never changes.
Yeah, she
even
always
Ingtar,
acts like that bitch.
Even Ingtar in his last moments still acts like a borderlander trained to fight the shadow at all costs. You know, it's
everybody has
blinder's eye till the last
day. For the most part, so many characters have such amazing redemption arcs. And Aviendha is a unique example of someone we get to see go from somebody that was already in a secure, comfortable position into just absolute obscurity. She has no idea how to be a wise one. She has no idea what to do with the fact that she just fucked her near sister's love interest. Like
someone she genuinely hates.
Yeah.
Like she legit hates him. Like
could you imagine the feeling someone that you just betrayed, someone you genuinely love, with someone you genuinely, whether it's because of what they represent or whatever, until that moment, hate. Until you make a conscious decision.
At that point, I think that really legit.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, obviously, Aviendha knows.
I get what you're
saying. There's a part of Aviendha that knows that she enjoys being by Rand because there's things she does.
Yeah, her loin. And, right.
Yeah.
That's the part that knows.
Her ovaries quiver when Rand is around.
I would even say, hashtag men writing women. No, I would even say that she doesn't hate Rand. I think in the beginning, at the start, she thinks Rand is a silly little, you know, country bumpkin who don't know nothing. And then she's told in her visions that she will fall in love with him. And I think at that point in time, she genuinely hates him. Then, because she's like, oh, screw that guy. He has no G. He is not even Aiel. No, this is not someone that I'm going to fall in love with. Then you have the confrontation with Culloden, and she's like, okay, no, seriously, 100% fuck this guy. No. And at that point in time, she's kind of fighting fate, right? But as she learns more about him, and as she sees at this point in time, anyway, that he is sincere, he is desperate. And no matter what happens, no matter how insurmountable the odds are, and especially knowing that he intends to die on the rocks of Shio Ghul, she looks at that and she goes, wow, this guy has tremendous G, but I still hate him for what he will do to my people. And it's very, very difficult for her to sort of reconcile that.
But yeah, I don't think she loves him because it's fated or destiny or anything like that.
No, absolutely because
not. What we learn later on is all the futures that she sees are possible futures. Egwene, when she was being tested and had to forsake Rand, that was a possible future for Egwene and Rand. Had she stuck by Rand,
it never actually comes to fruition.
Yeah. Right.
Had she stuck with him in the life they most likely would have led, Rand would have never become the Dragon Reborn that the world needed. He would have gone insane because he never would have done what he does in Winter's Heart.
He never would have left the Two Rivers.
Yeah. And she would have had to watch as the father for children, her love and husband slowly went insane. And the thing that makes the testing so important and so worthwhile is it's not just a scenario. It's real. Because when you're in that test, it's that you're flooded with the emotions and feelings and memories you would have had this actually happened, which is why we have the theory about the link between the test and Mirror Worlds. But that's not the topic of this discussion. Aviendha, falls.
This arch is real.
Aviendha falls in love.
I'm in an arch and I'm going fast and I'm seeing all the possible futures of my life.
If you'd like us to do a show about Mirror Worlds, then please leave a comment on our social media platforms.
And smash that like button.
I fully believe that Aviendha falls in love with Rand because of who and what he is. Regardless of his faults, there's a part of Aviendha that looks past all that and is just inexcusably attracted to Rand.
She admires the man that he is because, again, as I said before, it doesn't matter the odds, doesn't matter the challenges.
Don't tell me the odds.
She looks at him and sees someone quite literally screaming defiance and spitting in Sightblinder's eye at the last day.
Yeah.
And he may not be Aiel, but he is.
Which is a fantastic segue. How can anyone not
be impressed by that?
Which is a fantastic segue, because I want us to get to at least just before the events of Era Demon before we call it quits on this part. Because this, obviously, this is going to have to be a multi-part episode. because we're...
I don't know. I feel like we're actually getting to a good end here. And this might be a good place to...
This feels like a good end because we've been stagnant on the same topic for the last, like, 2 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, really? Tell us if you'd like a part two. Oh, of
they're getting a part two.
Yeah, they don't have a choice.
But I mean, I think they can still tell the next part, the next events that happen in regards to Aviendha tie in so well with the current discussion and what we're talking about with Aviendha. Because ultimately, what we're talking about is Aviendha coming to terms with feelings that she had never conceived or thought of or entertained before having her spears broken. Because she's got this commitment already to Elaine that she will make sure that nobody steals Ran from her, that nobody messes with Ran. It's a lady and warrior's agreement that nobody's gonna fuck with my man. And Aviendha literally fucks her man. And so Aviendha is forced with this feeling, this great amount of toe to Elaine, because she's like, I fucked up. I did something against my
own. Literally fucked.
Yeah.
I
literally fucked.
And
this is actually one of my favorite Aviendha moments. I know Andrew's favorite Aviendha moment, but my favorite Aviendha
every single
is
one
when
of them.
She is on her way to Saladar, where Elaine is. And she's got a knife and a stick.
Oh no, she is accompanying. Well, oh wait, no, you're right. Sorry.
She's got a knife and a stick, and she's whittling this stick down. And Rand is like, "Oh, Matt, okay, I need you to take the band over to Saladar." And Matt's like, "What? Okay, first off, I'm not in charge of these guys. Like, they're just following me. Okay?" And Rand is like, "Yeah, okay,
And Rand's like, right. Yeah, sure. That's literally the definition of you leave.
Okay, them. Fine, nice Matt. You go and magically all this army you've amassed will somehow follow you.
Right.
I don't care how that, you do it.
Just everybody's so quick to be like, Rand, you fucking egomaniac. You think you're putting on airs with your silk cloaks. And I'm like, Matt has literally amassed an army. And they all call him Lord Matt. Is anybody going to call him down? No.
And also, just look at how much lace he has.
Right! Anyway, I digress.
That motherfucker is lacy as shit.
Hashtag BTP tangent. Rand comes into Matt and he says, I need you to get to Saladar. I need you to get Egwene to safety. I need you to get Nynaeve to safety too, because, yeah, Nynaeve is there too. And then,
because like also Nynaeve,
he says, "Oh, and by the way, this is Aviendha. She's Aiel, and she really wants to go to Saladar. So, you know, let her go." And then Matt, when he brings in all of like the
let her go
the leaders of the band, and he's like, "Okay, everybody, we're going to Saladar. We're not going," because at this point in time, they were in an infantry march down to, was it Ilion?
Correct.
Because they were trying to look like they were going
they
to
were
attack
going
Samael.
To be fighting Samael.
And it was a feint. And that's why Matt agreed to it, because he didn't actually.
Wait, Matt fainted?
It was a feign.
It was a feint.
Whatever. Sorry. You know what?
It's not a feign.
I blame the taint. Hashtag blame the taint. This blame the taint moment has been brought to you by Josh, who's drunk. No, so Rand says, Matt, divert your course, go to Saladar, and oh, here's Aviendha, bring her with you. So Aviendha's sitting there whittling the stick, and Matt's like, okay, I got a crazy Aiel chick. I got Alvar, who does not like Aiel chicks. And what do I do? So what he does is he calls in the lords, and he goes, okay, everybody, we're going to Saladar. And then he says, oh, and by the way, this is Aviendha. She's Aiel. She'll probably try and stab you with that knife if you offend her, but she'll probably end up stabbing herself instead.
And all the Aiel laugh.
And Aviendha laughs.
She
so
like,
hard.
Doubles over laughing. And Matt's like, what the fuck did I just say?
And Rand's like, this position looks familiar.
Wow.
Hey. No, but Matt is like, he's like, okay, I just want
hashtag
her to know
I can
that
see the taint.
Hey, yo.
You have toe.
You have, hashtag yeah, you have
toe. 10 of them.
Heyo. No, but Matt's like, okay, I don't know what I said that was so funny, but now I'm going to Saladar, which is full of Aes Sedai. Yay, my favorite. And he's just trying to like take some of his aggression out, and Aviendha just like, she's like, can't even breathe. She's laughing Zar. And it's one of my favorite moments. It's one of the moments that sticks out to me the most in the series, because it's one of those brilliant cultural moments where, you know, cultural clash ends in a positive way. I think a lot of writers write cultural clash in a negative way, where you say something that accidentally offends someone, blah blah blah. And I think Robert Jordan,
Robert Jordan does that pretty regularly.
He does, for sure. But I don't think he gets enough credit for writing cultural clashes that are positive
taint fence
in nature. And there are many interactions where someone accidentally does something that pisses someone else off, of course. But then there are also other situations where people do things accidentally that make other people laugh and think, you're actually pretty cool. Come, let's have some ale.
Right? No, it's and I think this is actually after, if I'm not completely mistaken, I actually feel this is after the event that we've talked about on this show before, which is Rand tells a long-winded Wetlander Emmonsville joke.
He passed me just a moment ago and didn't even say hi.
To a group of Aiel. I passed him just a moment ago and he didn't say two words to me.
It's gotta be about the water.
And he absolutely gets no response.
Just bombs.
He literally tells a blonde joke kind of thing. And the Aiel are like,
what happened to the water?
About... Yeah, is this about the water?
It's got to be about the water.
Like, and then Matt's like, hey, guys, she's probably going to stab you if you look at her wrong, but she might stab herself instead. And she bursts out laughing. And Matt's like, I was there when Rand told his best joke. Dude. And no one laughed.
I didn't even think about it from that perspective. Like, Matt is like,
what the fuck just happened?
Matt, I could see Matt being like, that joke is hilarious at the village green on Beltane.
I guarantee you, like, I could see Matt looking at his hand like, all right, he falls in love with this noble hoity-toity chick from Camlin who's a prick. But they get along. Okay, fine. So now he's got this IL wise spear maid thing, whatever she is,
all over him.
Far Dareis wise one.
Yeah.
And Far like, Dar wise maid.
And he gives his best effort to make a joke and nobody laughs. Like, at that moment, I'm pretty sure Matt is just like, what kind of psycho motherfuckers does this guy that I call one of my best friends attract? Because he doesn't
why
get
them. Chicken cross the road to get to the other side? Eh?
Heyo.
Eh? Eh? Nobody? No. Okay. It must be about the water.
But
cool.
Any whore. They get to Saladar, right? Matt does his whole shtick with Egwene. Hey, they just named somebody Amarylin. See, let's get out of here. Stop calling yourself that, or they're gonna, you know, switch your bottom or something. And Egwene's like, nah, like, bruh, legit. You see the shit around my neck? I run this bitch. And Matt's like,
What stole is this, Horn Sounder?
That's right.
And immediately Egwene is like, huh. So your job is to make sure Elaine stays safe, right? Because that's what Rand told you to do. And he's like, I'm doing it in my own bloody fucking fruition. Because he mixes first age and third age swears. And so Egwene sends Elaine and Nynaeve off to Ebu Dar. Aviendha is like, I will go with them. And Egwene's like, cool, you saved me once. Cool. Do what you want.
Right.
All this happens.
Do what you want.
Aviendha has what any of us would consider a very awkward conversation with Elaine that surmounts to that basically amounts to the I fucked your man, and Elaine saying, it's okay, you're my near sister, I'll try to embrace this.
Well, and also, then it's funny in that conversation because Aviendha looks at her and she goes, okay, so I have something really awkward to tell you. I had sex with Rand. And Elaine looks at her and goes, I kind of knew this was going to happen.
Right.
Because Min told me about
right.
it.
That's and right.
Gives Aviendha an Angreal.
Yep.
Correct.
The woman-shaped Angreal. Then all this happens in Ebu Dar. They get the Bowl of the Winds. They use it. Fan-fucking-tastic. The weather seems to be fantastic for now. And they make it to Camelin. And Aviendha meets Min, and a voice in the background cries out, there is another.
There is another.
That boy is our last hope.
Fucker.
So they have their asterisk woman circle, dragon circle meeting, and they all decide, not only do they all agree that they love Rand unconditionally, but they are friends and are willing to share.
And I will say, I think I have to take Andrew's side here and say that this is a good place to wrap it up, because Veins of Gold is one of the greatest scenes in the book. I have to say that. And I could talk for an hour.
Not entirely my side, but close enough. Thank you. I guess.
Chapter. Well, you said you wanted a part two. Okay.
Oh, no, we have to do a part two.
The part two side.
All right.
Wait, isn't this where Aviendha is done?
I think just
this is where she leaves the story.
I think just like Elaine, Aviendha, and Min, we're all on the same side of there needs to be another part to this.
Well, not only that, but this is where they all meet, I guess, is the best part. They all agree.
I think it's a good wrapping up point, Giggity. Because that's not what happens.
So wrap it and tap it. This is your reminder from the Black Tower podcast to stay safe. Use protection.
Yeah, don't be like Rand or you could end up with twins.
Hey, twins.
More than twins, motherfucker.
Twins. So when it comes to the last word.
Motherfucker's got more kids than Angelina Jolie.
I will say this.
Who's the one that adopted all the kids?
That's Angelina Jolie.
Is it? Okay. I was right. All right.
When it comes to kind of like the final word on the subject, when you talk about Aviendha, I feel like Aviendha is one of the unsung heroes of the story. I mean, she's a main character, so a lot of people like to talk about her and talk about how badass she is.
Yeah, because everything she does is out in the open, where they think everything that Min does doesn't exist because they can't read them between the lines.
I think that
hashtag not salty at all.
Hey-o. I think
yes. Whereas Min Aviendha, to most people is a lamp, Aviendha is a spotlight.
Shut your mouth! We don't say that name here.
Looking at you, Dusty Wheel. Just kidding.
Lamp.
We all know Matt doesn't describe to that theory.
No, he does not. But he
not
likes
even a theory. That sentiment. That false narrative. That true untrue seen in fake news.
So Aviendha is talked about as a badass, but I think that if people really kind of take a second to look at her situation and sort of the norms that she has to break out of, I think that people would be much more impressed
with
Aviendha as a character.
I have not the name for this episode, but I have the name for part two. Aviendha Beyond the Igloo. Please don't let me forget that name. Yeah, I'm putting it in our private chat. Yes, guys, we have a private chat. Big surprise.
I think Aviendha is one of the characters who stands firm as a cornerstone of everything that holds Rand together, and it's her example that we should all learn from.
Are you getting
stand true?
You
to
get
who
double
you
entendre
are
there,
and where you come from. But to be open to new ideas and new things, even if they challenge what you understand to be true. And Aviendha personifies this beautifully.
Do you get the meaning there? She holds Rand together, and their first moment was in an igloo.
Nice.
Yeah.
And that's my final word. That's my final word.
Daniel, can have nice things. Daniel, before you forsake the podcast because you're tired of our shit, What are your final thoughts on Aviendha?
Well, it's funny because, you know, we've talked about, again, with the other two, with Elaine and Min, sort of what they bring to the table as far as what they provide to Rand as the Dragon Reborn, in terms of what he needs to learn between being the wool-headed sheep herder from the Two Rivers to Tarmin Guide. And, you know, we talk a lot about, like, you know, Min is the heart of the operation. Aviendha is the dagger of the operation. She's the brawn. And Elaine is the brain in terms of, you know, again, each of them teaches him a different thing that's associated with, okay, what are the, you know, Deus de Mar kind of things that you're going to need to do to actually get the nations behind you? Okay, what is the, how can we humanize you to have you not forget that people are people and not see them as numbers and statistics, but actually see their lives rather than fodder to throw at the shadow? And, you know, again, it actually sort of breaking down Aviendha's character and talking about her, I really think that, like, yes, we talk about Aviendha as Rand's strength, as kind of a cornerstone that he leans on, as far as taking a lot of just sort of pure, unadulterated, you know, willpower and strength of heart and whatnot from Aviendha's example. But one of the things that we don't actually talk that much about is just how much strength of will he takes from Aviendha, not necessarily in the, oh, she's so strong of a heart, and oh, she's so, you know, strong of body and all of this different stuff, but that in the midst of Rand going through all this absolute tumult, going from being the wool-headed sheep herder from Emmons Field who knows nothing but raising sheep to being literally the most powerful being in Randland and having his entire world turned upside down. I think that he actually takes a lot of solace in the fact that if Aviendha can do it, I can do it, kind of thing. And I think that, like, again, that kind of gets glossed over a lot in the sort of, again, not necessarily going to say, you know, toxic masculinity, but sort of the brute force of Aviendha's character.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of what she brings to the table is being so strong, so physically strong, so, you know, body and soul, whatnot, and we don't really think about how much fortitude Aviendha really had to have to not just, I guess at that point it would be, you know, throw down her shawl and leave the Aiel because she doesn't have her spears. But, you know, there really is, especially for her, even more of a sort of, you know, despair from learning all of the different stuff that she does about the Aiel. And I just have to admire and commend Robert Jordan for, again, writing such a real character that falls back into her tropes all the time. But at the end of the day is such a different and stronger person by the end of the story than she was at the beginning. And again, how much absolute life-changing bullshit she has to go through to get from point A to point B.
I like it. I like it a lot.
I like it too.
So for me, Aviendha is a very good representation of both harsh and not so harsh, and even relieving reality. because this entire time we see that Aviendha is going through and she's trying to teach Ran IO customs and what IO humor is and just everything about the culture that he was born of but never knew of or never really knew. Mm-hmm. She is, I mean, well, obviously she's a teacher. She's trying to teach him all right. this stuff. But the things that happen
and
between
yet she's also not a teacher at all.
But the things that happen between the two of them help Rand realize absolute reality. You know, that mm-hmm. yes, we are from totally different cultures, but you know, like we see in Fires of Heaven, beyond the obvious physicality of it, is you have two people from vastly different cultures that have fallen in love and developed a relationship and you know, became a thing. We see Aviendha continuously being the counter to what we see Rand and everybody else. I mean, we always see Rand and company interacting with new Wetlander cultures and stuff. And then you have the IL as this drastically different culture with a completely different spin on what humor is, on what honor is, on what it means to be a good leader, what a leader actually is. And it's a crucial part because you get Elaine teaching Rand what it means to be a Wetlander or a Randland, Westlander, whatever you want to call it, leader. What that entails, what that means, and what comes with it. But then you also see Aviendha teaching Rand, like, not just this is a different culture, but as much as the people in the Westlands are your people, these are your people too. And I think yes. one of the most incredible things she does is, wise one or not, Aviendha is still, throughout the entire series, very much a Far Dareis Mai to the core. And mm-hmm. she's one of the chief proponents for the Far Dareis Mai when it comes to, I don't want them fighting, I don't want them on the front lines because they're going to get killed and I can't handle women being killed. And it's a combination.
Bag of dicks, Rand.
Yeah. I mean, well, for me, like with my upbringing, it's a sentiment I can very much resonate with. I never want, not from an inequality standpoint, but just based on my upbringing and how I was, I don't want women have to sign up for the draft. On equality, by all means, draft every American citizen, or not draft, but for the Selective Service. Yeah. Which is an ironic name because it's not selective, unless you're female currently.
Get to the point.
If you're 18 years old, sign up for the draft. And it's kind of like that same kind of sentiment. Like before the sentiments that I was taught about what equality actually means and what it means to be an equal society, I would have never batted an eye. I would have never thought that it was unequal. I would have thought that's just the way things were. And Rand is very much the same. Men go to battle, men fight, men lose their lives to defend the homeland. And then he's met with this completely different culture to where everybody fights. Everybody defends the homeland. Everybody does what they have to do. Yeah, there you go. And Aviendha helps him understand this. I mean, the Far Dareis Mai do a very big part of it by themselves. And helping him. But she lays the foundation work for him understanding what IL honor and culture is. And it's because of that foundation that he can ultimately understand why he is insulting and dishonoring all the Far Dareis Mai by mm-hmm. trying to keep them away from battle. Because that's
right.
almost the worst thing you can do, if not the worst thing you can do to a warrior, is deny them participation in battle. I mean, we haven't gotten there yet. We get the scene where all the Far Dareis Mai line up and they're all coming in. It's everyone that's even there offering him their spears to break because he's not using them the way they are trained and they feel they should be used.
I feel like that happens later.
Yeah. I mean, it's still covered by the spoiler, but not by the episode. But
correct.
I think she's a very good anchor point in grounding in reality and what war means and what it means to be a warrior and the sacrifices you have to make, whether you're the one wielding the spear or the one directing the spear.
Well, And nobody's, and that's a good point to make. Nobody's perfect in this series. Nobody. Nobody is the perfect paragon. We don't have any Gandalfs. We don't have any Obi-Wans. We don't have anyone who is perfect.
Yeah.
Everyone makes mistakes.
I know you really like Star Wars.
Hey.
But the fact that you just said that Obi-Wan was perfect hurts
me
to my core.
Shut your whore mouth.
Perfect.
Ewan McGregor didn't do
perfect.
Everything he did
Obi-Wan
for you to fucking talk to him about
perfect.
Like this.
Obi-Wan is not perfect. We will have an entire episode.
Have you seen
on how
his
Obi-Wan
beard in the Clone Wars animated series? That is
Daniel,
perfect.
You'll find that many of the truths we're told depend greatly on our point of view.
That's true.
You're right. And some point of views can just be incorrect.
But guys, this is going to do it for part one on
indeed
the Far Dareis Bay Aviendha.
Far Dareis Bay.
What kind of stuff has already happened up until when Aviendha meets Min and Elaine and Camelin that you felt deserved more talking about, more time for us to talk about? And with that, what kind of stuff, what events, what things that happen are you looking forward to us talking about going forward? If you know about it. If you don't, then yeah, spoiler warning was through the entire series because there are elements
right.
that go through the entire series, but you've been spared from the vast majority of them. But true. Next week, we have every intention of being back with part two on Aviendha. The last of the three main dragon-sworn ladies, which means at some point in the relatively near
the
future,
last of the dragon riders.
Yeah, at some point within the relatively near future, you know, there's got to be an episode on your boy Rand before we can do an episode talking about their relationship.
Hmm.
You mean 7 to 12 episodes on Rand?
It's so deep.
I am hoping that we can keep it to 3.
I mean, Rand does get pretty deep.
He does.
He's pretty tall with big feet, so
it's true.
You know that's happening.
Thank you so much for tuning in to this episode. Before Daniel can make another bad rhyme of the Wheel of Time podcast, commonly known as the Black Tower podcast. It has been our pleasure to give you your weekly dose of madness, and we appreciate
it. Has been our pleasure to give you your weekly
here.
Pleasure.
It's been our pleasure to pleasure your taint.
We love to pleasure the taint, that is true. I have been your Soravan Mahail, Josh.
And I have been your Bajan Mael, your storm leader. Andrew, not Storm. What
your
the
battle
fuck?
Leader.
Battle hey, leader.
You horning in on my rank, bro?
Yeah, you know, it's interchangeable.
Something like
I that. I focus too much and on the not like pausing and not enough on the words to say. Anyway, I have been Andrew.
That's great. And I have been Daniel, and I hold the flag. And everyone,
you hold
good
the
morning. I hold the pole, and I hold it stiff. With my taint flapping in the breeze. And in case we don't see you again, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, good evening, and get the fuck out of here. No, and everyone, good night.